Hello and welcome to Frozen Cups and Hot Chips. I'm your host, Terrell Ducree. We're tackling mental health, trials and tribulations, the pivots and the growth. We're here with Antoine Newsome, here with River of Life Church in Chesapeake. Thank you so much for joining us. Hello and welcome to the latest edition of Frozen Cups and Hot Chips. I'm your host, Terrell Ducree. As we forge ahead into 2022, a lot of us are still carrying baggage over, as well as unresolved trauma from the previous year, and more importantly, from this overall pandemic. And of course, mental health sets in within the homes all across America. It's a taboo discussion. It never really makes it to the dinner table. And in particular, in families of color, it really doesn't raise its head in any of our topics. However, it's always there, sometimes silent, sometimes a much more louder message. We're delving into our mental health series here on Frozen Cups and Hot Chips. And of course, you know, we always speak with the experts, a lot of those that are trained in their field. And then, as it is with my current guests, some that are generals because of the battlefield of life. Mr. Antoine Newsome, thank you so much for being on Frozen Cups and Hot Chips.
I thank you. It's a privilege and honor to be here with you, and thank you all for considering me and having me on your awesome podcast, man. Frozen Cups and Hot Chips. I would never think that I would be a guest on such a special occasion. I really appreciate y'all having me.
So we are celebrating your third year anniversary here in River of Life. Talk to me about it.
Yeah, I cannot believe we just ended up in 3 years, and we just actually hit that target date. Last Sunday made it official that it was our third year being in ministry. I invited one of my personal friends over, Pastor Kelsey Little, came in, and he blessed our church with a great message and was with us in the celebration. And we just was very appreciative of the moment, and just cannot believe the fact that we actually made it this fast to 3 years.
Well, you know, and of course, us being friends and knowing you and knowing your story, you know, I remember the early day stories or moments where we were talking about you building and what your vision and message was going to be for River of Life. But now, 3 years post that, building a congregation, listening, learning the rigors of what, you know, folk are going through, being a messenger, a rather young pastor. Talk to me about what you've learned and your installment.
Yeah, I mean, fortunately, I'm under a great, great bishop, our very own legend, living legend right now. Bishop Kim W. Brown is our bishop, and he's my personal, me and my wife, our pastor, and so we have excellent mentorship of guidance and direction and teachings and trainings. And so we just never was left on the island by ourselves. So we really are like a sponge and taking in everything that is offered for us to learn and for us to take in. And we just applied it to our ministry. So that really has been a good cheat sheet and a shortcut to help us along the way in this journey.
You know, speaking of growth, and I like that, you've had some technological growth here as well within this pandemic. You guys have made a pivot both with how you stream and your acquisitions from the technology. Talk about that.
Listen, when you started out, I never had wanted to be a public figure that I had to be live and in front of a live audience every time I touched a microphone. That was not my dream.
We're gonna talk about who at high school. Let me see, he capping as the kids like to say, yo.
Well, I mean, you know, I've always was like a class clown, always was in front of people, all that good stuff, and sat in a singing group. I had that life and growing up and being with under Timberland and Missy Elliott and all that stuff during that time, growing up as kids in a singing group and stuff. But I never thought that in this assignment over my life, that I never did it to be like in a T.D. Jakes or Jamal Bryan, guys like that, that every time they touch the mic, they expect to be in front of a camera. I did not really, that was not my desire. I struggled with just doing the assignment as a whole. And that, so I didn't actually, to be truthful, I didn't even have the confidence to be like, yo, like, I don't even know, you know what I'm saying, like, if I'm good enough. Cause you know, you beat yourself up as a person too. Like that every time I speak is in front of cameras. But this pandemic, have made anybody that was second guessing themselves, was unsure, have any uncertainties or anything like that. You just look. You had to just. I guess they say you had to put your big boy panic pants on and say,
fact.
Look,
yes.
hey, I got to just do what we have to do to be able to survive as a ministry. So when people couldn't come out the house and do what they had to do, so we just had made an investment. We really like remodeled. We just redid everything.
It's
we painted.
Right here.
We did the lights. We did the wall, the LED wall. I mean, we just went from ground zero, and we had to make it pretty much like a studio to present. Mm. Able to give a great quality of live stream. You got people right. to just basically cutting their cell phones on, and it sounds like that. I mean, we had to get the audio and the video correct.
You were in the early stages during this pandemic. I can attest.
Yeah.
And you can certainly see the benefits of the fruits of your investment.
Yeah, man.
Staying right in that lane, as a rather young pastor, and that's gonna also pivot us into your upbringing and how you even got onto that path. I mean, it's one thing to, as they like to say, be in the church. It's another thing to preside over those and have an influence. I want you to take us back. Talk to me about 1996, Indian River High School, and you touched on, I like that, musical background. Mm-hmm. You're extremely talented. You know some folk.
Mm-hmm.
He knows some folk. Talk to me about what led you on this path to presiding over congregation one. Mm-hmm. But just tell us about Antoine Newsome.
Yeah, well, I've always had an assignment over my life. I've always God just have gifted me to not be afraid of people, being in front of people. I always, I guess. Did not mind the spotlight. I was always the class clown. I was on the football team. We won the state championship my senior year in high school
okay.
in 1995. And we was the first school that won the championship in Chesapeake. And that was a great experience. But I used to take on the whole bus. Like everybody on the bus used to try to come joke me. And I used to joke the
whole you're a bad
bus.
Boy now, no question.
So it just was a gift. Like, man, like I did not mind being in front of people. I did not mind. And sometimes I didn't win all the time. I mean, sometimes they'll rally up and they'll take me out.
Oh, yeah.
But it was a challenge, the fact that it was like, look, I got to get this guy. Like, they got to get me. So it was a fun experience, man. And that's been truly like, you know, how my life has been. And so I knew that something, God had called me to ministry when I was very, very young age. I was probably like early 20s, 21, 22. And I became a minister here at this church under my father.
Wow.
My father was a pastor here for over like maybe like 21, 22 years.
Okay.
He was a pastor here. And that's what brings us here today. My father had wrestled with some internal issues he was having mentally. My mom had passed away in 2005 with the battle of cancer. Mm. And my father really never was the same guy. When the day we buried my mom, he was just never the same person. He had good moments and good days and maybe a good month, maybe a good year. But he still was not this just the same. Me being a son and knowing him,
right.
All the years I knew him, just never was the same guy, man. And the end of 2018, it was 18, yeah. It was 3 years, yeah, 18, 19. That end of that Christmas, that Thanksgiving holiday, he actually had committed suicide. And it was like the biggest news in our city. All the pastors was just talking about it, and they was just, and so it just had different emotions with it, man. Like you're dealing with the loss of a parent, you're dealing with the how you lost them,
right?
Lost them, and then you're dealing with also the embarrassment of it as well.
Dive into that. That's what did that feel like?
It, because of the fact, I think if my father was like maybe in another profession, you know, if he was doing something else, and I don't want to name a profession to offend somebody else,
sure,
and what they do, but if he was doing something else other than pastoring, and because he was a pastor, it just put that extra little sauce on top of it of like, you know, like he's been a messenger all these years.
Right.
He's been a man that believed in the word of God, preached the word of God, and then would do such of an act at such as that. And so it's just been humiliating, you know, just to deal with that fact. And you just see people when you walk in spots and restaurants and places, it's getting a little better now because it's aging some. But when it first had happened, man, I mean, you just saw the, oh, hey, that's the guy there, that's the that's the man there, that's dad, that, you know.
Yes.
So I dealt with that a lot.
And
my
keep
family,
it a buck.
My kids.
And not to cut you off, but as the kids like to say, to keep it a buck, you know, Antoine knows a few folk. I meant it when I said it. So as you can imagine, having that as a stigma and having everyone that sees you mention that, their eyes talk, even if they don't say it.
Yeah, and I've always ran away from my call. That's another thing too, man. Like, I made choices. I was a church boy, born and raised inside the church, and I just wanted to do me. I wanted to experience the streets. I wanted to experience clubbing. I wanted to experience the women. I just wanted to do me, and
true.
I was doing me, and trust me, and I know a lot of preachers like always like to preach and say that, like, I was living in the world of sin. Look, I was having a ball.
Okay.
Trust me when I tell you, I was having a ball. I was enjoying myself, and then one day, the rug of that life was just pulled from under my feet. And but the whole time, God always was dealing with me. It was crazy. And I tell my church already know this story, so they might be bored by this interview, because I speak about my life
all
the time.
Talk to them Frozen Cups,
but
folks. Let them know.
I'm talking
that's
to the Frozen Cup audience, that
that's
people
right.
that say, yo, I used to party with this guy.
Mm.
Yeah, that's
Bingo.
Me. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, I saw this dude on the streets. Yeah, that's me. You know what I'm saying? I that's what I done. That's what I, and that's a part of my story. And I tell people, I one of the messages I preached recently is, all that I'm not is who I am. Like, I don't try to be nobody else. All of my my unfortunate things that happened to me, all that, the qualifications I don't have, whatever it may be that I lack in me, that's who God made me to be. And so that's what I embrace. I embrace the full throttle. All that I'm not is who I actually am. And I'm excited about that.
I like that.
You know, and I'm able to, because what happens is people try to always be a copycat of who someone else is.
Yes.
And I've seen a lot of people be buried in character and never was buried who they was.
Who they really are. Wow,
and who they really are.
Word,
so I said, God, when I do this assignment, I want to come to it being truly who I am. So I come from the club to the pulpit. I didn't have no pit stop in between. Wow. I didn't have no place to lay down and
important.
Lay on my face and get myself together. I've always had an assignment over my life. I always was called to preach. Even when I was drinking, God would deal with me in the club and say, you know that you are wrong. You know that you don't belong here. Like, God always have dealt with me. I stand before the Frozen Cup and Hot Chips crew right now in front of everybody, in front of this wall with the name and logo behind me to tell you, God himself always had convicted me personally. And so when it went down, man, when my father had pulled that that act, and he did that in his life, man, and ended his life that way, it was devastating. And so what happened, I saw my parents sweat and tears and the sweat equity they put their all into this ministry. And I just could not, as a son that was always a great son to my parents. Once again, I repeat, a great son. They never came to get me out of jail. They never had to come to a crack house to come pick me up. They never had to go to the school because I was that bad of a student. I've always been a modern good person to them. And and so, and I just felt like, even though they're not here, they raised me that way. And I was like, you know what? I'ma still try my best as much as I can to bottle up all of the history and sweat equity that they have put in the land, to put it all in a new motto that it can be still reflecting on what they have done, but I gotta take it and twist it and change it so it can work in this day of time.
Almost the proverbial passing on the traditions that you come from. It's the fabric of you.
Yeah.
Now, staying in that lane, that pastoral lane, but also in with the pivot to mental health. Now, you're absorbing a lot. You go through that loss here at recent. Not only the loss, but now you transition to presiding over others through a spiritual realm. But also, where's the therapy come in as a black man?
I'm glad you asked that question. I'm so glad you asked that question. What I do at our church is, anybody that sit in front of me that really, really has a deep real deep level of mental issues. When I see that the scripture would not be enough, when I see that the prayer for that moment to fix it, like from the time they are in my office to the time they get in their car. And what I realized is that I went to the dentist one day. I had a real bad tooth infection and a bit real bad toothache. And the doctor had gave me, he said, before I can perform the procedure, I have to give you a medication.
Yes.
He gave me the medication. And then I came back on the day that the procedure was scheduled. I said, Doc, I feel so good. I don't need the procedure no more. He said, listen, what we did is this. He said, don't get it twisted. He said, we treated the symptoms, but we did not fix the problem.
Y'all caught
that. And so I want people to understand that. So a lot of times people go to their pastor, and a pastor is a great symptom fixer, but they're not a great problem fixer. So when I see people with a way deeper mental issue, and I don't play with that subject because I dealt with a situation of suicide from a parent, that I quickly suggest go to the professionals. Let me say this to the people there.
Please talk.
Because you are a pastor, do not mean that you are experts in every different thing in life, every genre of life. No, if somebody come to you and they are not together mentally, the best pastoring thing that you actually almost can really do is pastor them to the place that can actually give them the professional help. So I'm a stickler with that. They'll tell you, my church will tell you, anybody around me, I really suggest go get the help. I mean, even when it went down, my wife had made sure that she signed us up, my kids, my sister, my wife herself, and also me. I never in my life thought I would be sitting in a I'm the pastor guy now, you know what I'm saying? So I don't think that I didn't think I needed some type of
I'm supposed
counseling.
To be the steady hand.
Yeah, I'm supposed to be the one, you know.
Talk to me about how the apprehension was there for you.
Man, and when I went there, I went inside the office, and I went there kind of like with the Marshawn Lynch attitude. My wife signed me up, and I was really there like, hey, I'm here so I won't get fined. That was my personality.
Okay.
That was my mentality with it.
Okay.
Man, that lady got to me, and that's why I said, go to the professionals. It was the way she was wording her questions, the angle she was coming from. And man, when I tell you, I broke down like I was 5 years old. The 5 year old in me came out in the room, even though the 40 year old in me was sitting down talking to the lady, but the 5 year old kid that just lost his father that way, I had a lot to say to him, and she made me have a conversation with him. And man, it was just so like life-changing experience. And that was a part of my healing process because I was able to get that out. So I just recommend people, man, look, mental health is serious. When you see people saying messages, you gotta hear. My mama told me this. She said, son, the greatest relationship you will ever have with a woman, if you could hear all what she is not saying to you. And so mental health is basically is the message that people are, they may say a little something on a text message. They may put something in the messenger. They may put something on their Twitter or whatever. But you gotta sometimes read the message that's behind the message.
Yes.
That they are trying to reach out. So you gotta be in a position to kind of like see the signs. That's another thing now, that because I've been through this actual trauma in my life, now I think I over...
Paint the picture for him, Antoine.
Well, like if somebody, you know, now even being a pastor, when I see someone coming here and they always like in a crying, it's because it's a difference between a worshiper and someone crying out of depression. You know what I'm saying? Some people, you know, would cry with tears of joy, tears of thanking God, rejoicing that, you know, for him being the God that he is. And then you'll see someone that will cry because they just always like in a funk or always just in a bad, dark place. Okay. So that's the thing that you gotta realize with mental health. Mental health only dwells in a dark place. You never see nobody happy and have mental health issues. Mental health issues is a place that is dark, is a lonely place.
Okay.
And you gotta be able to pick that stuff up and treat it. I believe the quicker you give it treatment, the better a person will have a chance to make it through it.
You know, that's a good point. And speaking of the dark place, sometimes when we are able to identify behind that veil of the message, being able to see, wow, we might need to ask again or make sure, how do we toe the line of being helpful not being intrusive, not making it feel like an intervention, because when your heart could be in the right place of wanting to ask those questions, but you can run the risk of pushing someone further back into the darkness and less expression, which also doesn't help. How do you toe the line?
So that's what I've learned the hard way. Is like, I think they're sitting there waiting for somebody to ask them the question. Mm. And I believe that we use that always to be the exit door or the escape goat of why not to really not approach it head on. Anybody that's really like need help, like for example, if you in a situation, you in a car accident, an ambulance riding by you, mm. and you need ambulance assistance, that's not helping you. They keep riding by you.
Mm.
What you would like is if for them to jump out their car and tap on that glass and say, hey, what hurt on you? Do you need any help? And that's what anybody that's in a dark place, they want somebody to knock on that window in their life and say, hey, what do you need from me? I'm here for you. You look like you can use some help.
Wow.
And I had to realize that the hard way, that and I regret. And that's another thing too, man, when you deal with the regret of when someone does that type of act in a life, man, the days you go to bed, just always replaying back conversations, replaying back moments that you felt like all they was trying to do, they was talking to me without talking to me. They was letting me know that it was not in a good place, but I just wasn't, I was just so busy in my world and in my life. And then what happens is when that whole thing happened, now it's like God rewinds days, rewind conversations, and you like, yo, he was saying this the whole time.
Wow.
And when you replay back moments.
Those pieces where he was dropping it to you and hoping you got it.
Man, and you just kick yourself in the butt days after days, hours after hours, moment, because you're just saying, now you're just evaluating yourself saying, look at how much stuff I could have done different. I could have been a better person at this moment. I could have been a better son at this moment. I could have just been a better listener at this moment. I could have been a better doer. You know what I'm saying? So that's the other part too. Not only going through the embarrassment, not only going through dealing with the actual loss, but then you go through the personal evaluation.
Wow.
That you're evaluating yourself totally different than how you would have pertaining to anything else. Like, man, could I have prevented that loss to go down that way? You know, right. So then another thing come in too, you know, you got other preacher friends and stuff that I have say, hey, you know, you can't stop nobody's day. Like, if that's their day that they're supposed to go. And I understand that too, but it's still that little piece in you, just as, because it's family and it's
true.
A loved one. And
I know I'm better than anyone else.
Yeah, and you just feel like you could have just have done something to kind of like make it be, it's like what you find yourself, anybody that do that type of act, you really find yourself like, man, if they could have just lived one more day, if they could have just made it through that night to go to the next day, like would life have been all right for them tomorrow than it was for them on that day? You know what I'm saying? So,
right.
It's
without
a lot of stuff,
without knowing what you're going through, I hear what you're saying, but I don't even want to be insensitive and say I know what you're saying.
Yeah.
But I hear you. And in that same vein, when you mentioned help, I heard you mention help a few different times, and that's deep. You're saying just one more day. Maybe I almost like the movie Groundhog's Day. When you almost, if I knew it was coming, maybe I could have said something or put something else out there into the atmosphere different. But when you mention help, talk to me about the resources that are available. Let's say we identify, I'm getting that message within, but then I'm not a licensed professional. Mm-hmm. I don't want to mess this up further. Mm-hmm. I've identified it, that ambulance riding by, that beautiful analogy that you mentioned. I need the ambulance to see me. Now that we got the fires, I need to put the fire out. What are some of the resources that worked for you? I like the story of the missus helping getting you in there, and I understand that we spoke off camera.
Mm-hmm.
You said you went from not talking to wanting to talk like it was the best thing since sliced bread, wanting to go back. Where are those outlets?
They're everywhere, man. I mean, you go online. That's the beautiful part about our Google system that we have on our earth now. There are different facilities all across. You even have Christian-based mental health places that will help you with different type of, they say you can't say shrinks now.
Oh, okay.
They say it's like saying midget or whatever with the short people.
Ah,
or whatever.
Okay.
So,
yeah.
But any type of counselors.
Mental health professionals.
Any mental health professionals, they have Christian-based ones. They have all different type that whatever your struggle is, if it's drug abuse. And then you also have ones that Sometimes your abuse causes your mental health issues. Like if you are in an abusive relationship, or if you are abusing drugs, can't kick certain different bad habits that end up being an abuse to your life or to you, they have people and specialists that's out there for all of that. So it's really on you to go on and research. I believe we will post some different places
The
link
as
well that we can recommend on our end. But there is a lot of different places to your, and I say it in my church all the time, to your liking that will be there for you to help you in a time such as this.
You know, your story is amazing. It's true. It speaks of grit, determination, and triumph. And of course, we still have a long way to go. There are a lot of mental health situations, issues within our family structure, within homes all across America, all over this world. We've got to have the conversation. We're talking to an expert who's dealt with it from a mental health piece. We're going to speak with the clinicians. We're going to talk about the facilities. A lot of those facilities that were around for funding issues are shutting down. Walking amongst us in town are not just homeless people. They are people that are walking amongst us with some real issues that need some addressing. We're going to touch on that. Frozen cups and hot chips. We talk to sports. We talk the judicial system. We talk about health, both mental and physical. We're just going to touch on everything. Tidewater Terrell will continue to speak with the best and the brightest, but I am so humbled. Thank you for sharing. You touched on a number of things that I'm sure the viewers will pick up on, will be able to benefit from. And this is not our last time. We're going to keep speaking on the journey. Salute to you on 3 years in this beautiful congregation. I appreciate you. One last word to someone who is attending any church USA. You spoke about, as a pastor, noticing the difference between that praise cry and that really hurt cry. To that person sitting in the last pew, what should any pastor be looking for? How can we help that person before it's too late?
Well, you have to really have put together a team that touch your people, that stay in communication, that help you and be eyes behind your back. Because as a pastor or even being a coach, you cannot see everything. So for the ones that do notice someone that seem like they can use that extra attention, that can use that extra help, feel free to professionally pull them aside and just ask them real nicely, very sweet, nice, calm, cool, and out of love, and just ask them the simple question, are you okay? And I promise you, they will have the waterworks already in their eyes, their tongue will follow their tears, and they will begin to express how they're feeling and what is going on in their life. And then you are able to say, okay, we can help you in this situation. It may be something that a pastor could or a congregation could do. It's been times that I've seen that, and I quickly say, look, let's bless this family. Like, she need to feed her kids. Mm. You know what I'm saying? Like, they haven't eaten in a few days.
They immediately
help. Yeah. That's our job. We can quickly raise an offering to, feed that family. We did here turkey baskets and stuff for Thanksgiving. When they come in and they ask for certain stuff, or because we paid attention and we saw that something was going on and we were able to immediately give them assistance. Mm. And it may have been something financially, it may have been something like a car part, or you got your congregations, we got people that's fill of different occupations, right. Mechanics, electricians. It may be somebody they may need, you know. And and you would not believe how something to you can be so small that actually can be like a big dinosaur to someone else's life. So we have helped people like you can think of it, man. And we were here to help them, and that's the whole purpose of why we even do what we do, is to be a blessing to people and help them mentally try to make it through. Just to make it to one more day, make it to the next day.
I like it. We'll be here to keep sharing your journey. That's Pastor Newsome. I'm Terrell Ducree, and you've been watching Frozen Cups and Hot Chips.
Peace out. We'll see you. River of Life, 10:30 a.m. Sunday mornings. and come and check us out, because you'll see how we flow here at the river. Frozen cups.
Yes.
And hot chips.